And now, back to the Johnny B Show.
Welcome back. Welcome back to Johnny B Show. 102.5 The Bone, Real Raw Radio. Monday night. Coming up later in the show, we'll have our meltdown. So if you got something that has you on edge, something you want to get off your chest, give us a call. And we'll do that in about an hour or so. So have your meltdowns ready. It is Monday, and it's not only Monday, it is Victory Monday. And that is my favorite kind of Monday. And we have our guy, Rhett Matthew from the Cannon Fire Podcast, on for our Bucs Break. Let's go to him now on the hotline. What's up, Rhett?
Oh, man, who doesn't love a good grilled cheese, Johnny? Happy Victory Monday, fellas. It's so goddamn good.
Grilled cheese, I love it, man. I didn't even think about that. My God. Like, maybe you ran a Vegas book, you know, and after it was 10-0 Green Bay, if you put a line out there, like, for final scores, how many people would have bet Buccaneers 38, Green Bay 10, 38 unanswered points. I'm still kind of beside myself. I can't believe that we went off like that. Like, I knew that we had the ability to beat him. I knew we had the ability to get pissed off and come back and punch him in the face after he did that dance in the end zone after the touchdown. But, man, they went off like an angry Bucs defense from like 2001. Like, I haven't seen that kind of defense from the Bucs in almost 20 years. It was nuts.
It was incredible. It was 180 degrees. It was tone setting. The Jamel Dean pick six really lit a fire under everybody's ass. But, you know, just the progress that they made from that Thursday night game. And yes, they had injuries. Yes, it was a short week. But the progress that they made, and something that I bitched about a lot last week after Thursday's game, was adjustments. Well, you know, after an underwhelming first quarter, we saw Aaron Rodgers and the Packers hang on to the ball for, what, 13 and a half minutes? And I thought they were just going to abuse us all day long. They were throwing those little curl flat routes, and, you know, they were just eating us up. And I'm like, all right, same old stuff. Here we go, 10-0. We're playing from behind. Maybe we get a touchdown. We're back into it. You know, the offense looked like it was stalling out early. And, like I said, that Jamel Dean pick six, from then there on, the best Buccaneer performance that, honestly, I think I've ever watched in my life. I know for a lot of people it's been many, many, many years since they saw the red and pewter under Raymond James just playing around in the football like that. These guys played as good of a game as they could have after that first quarter. And it makes it a lot easier to talk about it as well. When you've got less stuff to complain about, it seems like it's much better of a time.
Yeah, we talked about this Friday and, you know, talked about it with you last Monday. Like, you have 10 days to right your wrongs, to set the ship straight, right? Like, so you had that horrible, horrible, abysmal, just from a, you know, just from a execution standpoint, that game in Chicago, you had penalties all over the place. You had people running the wrong routes. You had missed blocks. You had blown coverages on defense. You had a pass rush really not getting there. You had all kinds of just weird problems when it came to that game, and it seemed like it snowballed. The worse it got, it was just too much. And we still lost by 1 point, right? To a Chicago team that handled Carolina pretty well yesterday. So we had 10 days to kind of get it right. And we didn't just get it right. It was like we fixed everything, it seemed. Like, this is the first time, I believe since 1999, that a team, I think it was that a team had no penalties, no turnovers, and
no sacks allowed.
No sacks allowed, and they also came. It was one of the first times that somebody has come back and beat a team by more than by 28. Well, they beat them by 28 points, and it was a team with a winning record after being behind in the first quarter. There's all kinds of weird stats that were getting thrown out today that was like, wow, All right, it looks like the Bucs set all kinds of records and milestones with this victory, all in one game. But all you need to do is look at, like, look at Aaron Rodgers' face in the third quarter. Not even the fourth quarter. He knew the game was over in the third quarter, and you could just see he was defeated. I have never seen Aaron Rodgers look that mentally rattled and defeated, man. It was unbelievable. They beat his ass. Like, physically, I was talking about this with Will earlier in the show. Like, to sack somebody is one thing, but they were punching him to the ground like a rag doll. It was like they were giving him, like, kung fu double-fisted punches in the chest. Like, Wah Nugent! You know, it was unbelievable. There was some clean hits that I thought, man, they should have called roughing the passer just because they made him look like that much of a bitch on the play. His family's watching. You know what I mean? That's embarrassing.
I'll tell you, something that brought a smile to my face, you know, looking at this game on the schedule when the season started, this was the game I was most excited for. You're playing Green Bay. It's an afternoon game, potentially under the lights. Well, I like to see them wear the red and pewter, but whatever. We got pewter pants for the first time this season, so that's okay, I guess. But shades of Warren Sapp just kicking the crap out of Brett Favre from Indomitable Sioux. I mean, every time he was in the backfield, he was jawing at Aaron Rodgers. And maybe it was pent-up frustration from playing on terrible Detroit teams all the time and, you know, watching Aaron Rodgers come in and throw 500 yards every year. But the defensive domination is what carried that game. And, you know, yeah, we can talk about Brady. We can talk about Gronk, who had his best game in a Buccaneer uniform. But before we get to any of that, like, we just really need to show some praise to this defense, because without the Jamel Dean pick six and without the great play from Carlton Davis to cause the Mike Edwards interception, I don't think the Buccaneers would have gotten back into this game the fashion they did. And the fact that that led to 38 unanswered points is just a testament to where this team is right now, because, to be frank, they're in a much better spot than I thought they were going to be, especially this week of all weeks.
Yeah, it was just an absolute ass whooping. It's the best way to put it. You could use whatever word you want, pummeling or whatever. But it was just an ass whooping. And like you said, grilled cheese is exactly what it was. And when you saw the press conferences afterwards, like LaFleur and Rodgers, they pretty much said that. Like, Coach LaFleur, I'm gonna say his name wrong, but he said, look, we had a mediocre week of practice, and apparently the Bucs didn't. And when that happens, you get your ass whooped, and we got our ass whooped. Like, he didn't say, you know, he didn't blame it on anything except the Bucs whipped their ass. Like, then Rodgers said that too, you know, and I'm paraphrasing. I don't have the quotes in front of me, but he basically said, look, every now and then you need a wake-up call, and this was a good one for us. Like, we're going to bounce back. We needed a smack in the face. And he said, we were kind of on our high horse because we had this explosive offense. And he goes, we have the national media saying that, our offense can't be stopped. And, you know, I guess we needed a smack in the face, because guess what? Guess whose offense got stopped? Am I wrong, Rhett? Because I believe I read the stat sheet that after their second touchdown, they had 70 total offensive yards after that.
Yeah, I think the stretch was 51 yards over like 45 plays for the Packers. I don't know if – yeah. It was a rough afternoon. Tough sledding for the before this game. Number one ranked offense in the NFL, as far as I know. Like, they were absolutely on a roll. And, you know, dude, I'm a really big fan of Pat McAfee's show. I like to listen to his show a few times a week. And Aaron Rodgers was on there last week. And that's right. I don't know if it was last week or the week before, but he made that snide comment where he's like, oh, well, you know, a bad day for me is a career day for other guys. Well, I don't know how many guys are having a career day of zero touchdowns, two interceptions, and getting put on your ass more times than I can count. Dude, they beat him so bad that in the last 7 minutes of the game, we just had a preseason game. Like, everybody their starters. You saw
it screwed me. Dude, do you know what that did for my Johnny B Show FanDuel League? I was sitting in fourth place, and I was 14 points away from first place. Everybody else's team was done playing. The three guys that were in front of me in our fantasy league, our FanDuel League, they all had 1 o'clock games and they were all done. I had Brady, Scotty Miller, and Rojo, and I needed 14 fantasy points with 7 minutes left. And I look out there and goddamn Blaine Gabbert's marching out on the field. And Keyshawn Vaughn. And I'm like, oh no. And Grayson. I'm like, no. Give me one of those bombs to Scotty Miller. They don't beat the guy up and pass interfere him. Then I win our damn league. But you know what? I'll take fourth place so that none of our starters get hurt. But man, yeah, that sucked watching the backups come in when I was so close to winning the entire thing. But you know what? That right there is a testament though. Like that, like you said, that's a real ass whooping when you look out there and it's like little league football. It's like, all right, who hasn't played yet? Who hasn't played? Get midget Mikey. Mikey, come on, buddy. Come on. I don't want to play. My parents want me to play. I don't even like football. Get on the field, Mikey. Yeah, so they were just letting everybody play, just bringing them all in there. They were letting people that weren't even football players play if they wanted to. You know, I believe Carmen Vitale, she played wide receiver for one or two plays. Like, they just let everybody go out there and play. It was great. But the thing I love about this, the confidence, Rhett, going into next week, Sunday Night Football against John Gruden and the Raiders.
Yeah.
I'm excited
out
for this
there
one,
in the out there in the new and shiny Roomba Stadium that they built themselves out there in the desert. And
unreal.
What I like about this next stretch of games that the Buccaneers have, after Sunday's performance, as I mentioned earlier, you know, I think they're in a better spot than I really thought they were this time of the season. But these next few games, you've got the Raiders, which could be a tricky game. I think it'll be entertaining. I don't think the Bucs should lose. You know, I think they're a better team than the Raiders, but Vegas likes to keep it interesting this season, so we'll see.
Well, real quick about the Raiders, the thing you got to worry about with them. What Bucs team is going to show up? Are we going to get big-headed and have a weak practice, or are we going to ride this wave into the same kind of performance? And it's also the Raiders. They come out sometimes and struggle against a weak team, but then they go out and beat the Kansas City Chiefs. So I don't think we're not going to know what to expect from either team until halftime.
Absolutely. That's why it's going to make that game that much more exciting. But after the Raiders, they've got the Giants. No excuse. I mean, dude, if we lose to the Giants, it's over. You hang it up.
I'll lose my damn mind.
Week 9, you've got the Saints. Obviously, the Bucs seemed a lot better equipped to go up against the Saints in this matchup than they did Week 1. But when push comes to shove, I said this on the new CFP today, but if you are a championship team, which after Sunday, you know, Buccaneers look like they could get the ball rolling, really stack some wins together, and just look good for playoffs, you know. But if you are a championship team or you are the team that you're expecting yourself to be, this is where you stack some wins together. This is where you beat Vegas. This is where you beat New York. And this is where you split the series with New Orleans. I would hate to see this Bucs team play as well as they have just to get swept by the sorry-ass, old-arm Drew Brees New Orleans Saints who always find a way to get under our skin. But I really think this team has matured since Week 1 a lot. And just the level that we've seen them playing at, this is a stretch of games. It's pretty critical. And then after New Orleans, you got Carolina as well. I think you can beat Carolina. So these next four games are pretty damn important. You win 3 out of 4 of those, you're still in good shape to be leading the NFC South, and you want that for as long as possible. But pretty important stretch of game for the Bucs right here.
I'm pretty confident with the Saints game for one reason. We're undefeated at home.
Yeah, that's different.
Has anybody even thought of that? We're undefeated at home. We never win at home. We're like one of the worst home teams ever when it comes to the NFL. I just thought about it. We're 3-0 at home. Holy hell. It's a brand new day in Tampa Bay.
That's a good feeling to have, man. I'm looking forward to when they put the red and pewter on because I think we're long overdue, but it's a damn good feeling because, normally you have that road warrior identity, but the way that we're playing this year, I think the undefeated streak at home is what's a little bit more important, especially come playoffs.
Yeah. I mean, we don't want to get ahead of ourselves, but if you would have said it to be, you know, before the season, after Week 6, we'd be 4-2. I think anybody would have been excited and happy to take that. Definitely 4-2 is, it's a great mark, but It could easily be 4-4 if we don't keep our crap together. I'm looking at 10-6 as a realistic outcome for the season and getting into the wild card. But after yesterday, I'm starting to have different thoughts. I'm starting to have pipe dreams of 12-4 after yesterday. I mean, did you watch some of the national pundits today? All they talked about was Todd Bowles and this defense, and how not just aggressive they were, but how well schemed they were. I posted a screenshot yesterday that I took, watching the game, at some of these pre-snap looks that they're giving, that they gave the Packers yesterday. I'm like, what? You have no idea what's going on. They had Sue was at safety, Levante David's at corner. They had eight people on the line of scrimmage. You have no idea. And then when the ball snapped, it was a four-man rush. It was unbelievable. It was like, what the hell is going on? Like, I don't know. I think Todd Bowles might be the best defensive coordinator in the league, and he might be the best one we've seen in a long, long time. Definitely since Monty Kiffin in Tampa. What he did yesterday was remarkable, and if he could keep producing even close to that kind of defense, then there's no reason why we can't, cruise into the playoffs and no telling how far. So, yeah, I watched Dan Orlovsky today on ESPN. He was just basically screaming at the TV, the Bucs will win the Super Bowl if they play that defense every week. You can't stop them. Give them the Lombardi Trophy. The Bucs will win the Super Bowl. It's like, he's not wrong. Who's going to beat us if we're allowing 10 points to the Packers? Who the hell is going to beat us if we play that defense every week?
The Buccaneers definitely made their case to be one of the best, if not the best, NFL defense right now. And you got to give a lot of credit to Todd Bowles, because like you said, he has been the most impactful coordinator, especially defensive coordinator, that we have seen in Tampa in quite some time. They threw out that 4-3 scheme that was getting used and abused every single week. He implemented this weird hybrid 3-4, and I'll tell you what, of all the crazy-ass looks that they put out there, one of my favorites is it's a blitz that they run, and they use Ndamukong Suh as a standing linebacker. And he just stands there. He really doesn't even do anything. Like, they'll snap the ball, and maybe he'll come and bring some pressure. But for the most part, when you see Ndamukong Suh just walking towards the line, not in a three-point stance, I'm sure there's a couple of people on the offense going, what the hell is about to happen? And I know Aaron Rodgers said that just as many times, because as we saw on Sunday, he was laid flat out more times than I can count. But I really like the versatility that this defense has shown. And one of the things that they do a lot better than, a lot of the other defenses that I've seen is that they're just, dude, they're so fast. Like, they are hungry sharks out there. They swarm to the football. And, speaking of just this defense, the run defense was kind of in jeopardy this week. You lost Vita Vea in the Chicago game, but I think Nacho did a pretty serviceable job. I think the coaching staff likes what they see. He'll be a rotational guy, because they also made that trade for Steve McClendon, defensive tackle from New York. But the fact that they saw a hole, they addressed it. They got Steve McClendon. You can still use Nacho as a rotation guy. I like that. But what I'm trying to say is that there's so much to like about this defense that, dude, we could sit here and talk about it for an hour and a half. There's so much good right now, and it's all thanks to Todd Bowles.
Yeah. I think scheme is a lot. I think you could put a lot of pros, of average to above average skill level, and they're going to do well in that scheme. But yeah, I mean, guys like Ledbetter came in off to if I'm even saying his name right, but he came in off the practice squad yesterday and was taking on double teams while, Levante and Devin were running around, untouched, tearing people up. And when you say you're like hungry sharks, that's exactly how I felt. Every time they ran the ball, I knew that guy was about to get hit by one of two guys. And that's what happened. And they come fast, dude. When you see Devin White come in on a tackle, you don't even know where he comes from. He's there in a flash, and he wraps up. Nobody breaks a tackle from Devin White. And same thing with Levante David. And that's the talk that you're getting now. Now that we're getting national attention, you're hearing a lot of national pundits saying that we have the absolute best linebacking duo in the NFL. And you could try to argue it if you want to. I mean, I know Pittsburgh's got good linebackers. There's some good ones out there. But Levante and Devin White, I mean, it's lights out, man. They couldn't run. They couldn't go anywhere yesterday. And what made me so happy about that was that bulletin board material that Jamal Williams, I believe it was Thursday, he said, all I know is my quarterback knows how to count to four. Okay. All right, buddy. Go ahead.
You remember that delay of game penalty where he just looked around all lost because he'd just been hit so many times?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, how's it feel? How's it feel, buddy? All right, we got to do our predictions for this Sunday night. We touched on it briefly. The Bucs going into Las Vegas into a brand-new billion-dollar empty stadium to play the Raiders and John Gruden and a team that's it's very Jekyll and Hyde. You never know what you're going to get. They have the ability to play very, very well. And John Gruden's going to want to stick it to his old team, you know, the organization that let him go. We got to point out a couple key points to the game and of course get our score prediction. Last week, Rhett, you and I chose the Packers. Now Will thinks that I should keep choosing the other team because I'm a jinx, right, Will?
That's correct.
Well, I remember the last time that you said they were going to steamroll somebody and then that game happened. So you picked against them and they absolutely just crushed Green Bay. So I think that's the tactic going forward.
Yeah, I thought we were going to completely manhandle the Bears too. Yeah, I know. I'm okay. We'll see. All right, I'll pick last then. Will, what do you think is going to happen in Las Vegas Sunday night?
Well, if the Bucs play like they did this past week against Green Bay, they're going to do very well. No penalties. Did they have any penalties this week,
No.
Rhett?
Nope.
And they cleaned
None.
That up. They cleaned
Zero.
That up.
Second time in franchise history. Bucs have been a football team for 44 years, my friends, and it has only happened one other time that they had zero penalties. And
also,
as Johnny mentioned earlier,
no sacks and no turnovers. Yeah.
Yeah. So if they play like that
the first time this millennium.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, if they play like that, I mean, I don't know what they did in practice this week, but they cleaned up that problem in a hurry. And then Ronald Jones putting up over 100 yards again. If he performs this week, or goes over 100 yards, they don't have any penalties, they'll steamroll this game. I'm going to say the Bucs win 31-24.
Ooh, okay. All right. Damn. Who's going to be the MVP, Will?
MVP Ronald Jones. I think he goes over 100 again this week.
Okay, all right. What you got, Rhett?
Well, I've got the same exact score prediction as Will does. I was thinking in my head this whole time. This is a game where, you know, I think both teams could put up over 30 points. I think the Bucs defense will do a pretty good job of slowing down the Raiders, though. You know, they get the pressure again. They hit home on the blitzes. I think Derek Carr is a guy who can get razzled a little bit easier than Aaron Rodgers. And I also think that they're not that great at stopping the run. So just like Will brought up, you know, I'm looking forward to another big game from Ronald Jones because, yeah, you can throw Leonard Fournette back into the equation. But how badly do you really want to slow down Ronald Jones right now? Three straight 100-yard games. He's playing like a man possessed, and he's running pissed off. I love to see it. I don't even call him Ronald Jones anymore. He's Ron Jones now. He's Ron. But I'm expecting a big game from Ron Jones. I think the Buccaneers do come out victorious, 31-24. And my MVP, you know what? I'll say Ndamukong Suh. I think Ndamukong Suh is a follow-up to his damn good performance against Green Bay, and he's going to be the star on that defensive line on Sunday Night Football.
Huh. All right. Well, I'll give my prediction from my heart first. My heart says that the Bucs are going to win this game 42-17, right? But I don't want to jinx them. So my real prediction of Raiders pull this thing off in a last minute field goal and they win this thing 34-31, a real heartbreaker. The MVP for the Bucs is going to be Chris Godwin. He's going to go off. He had a warm-up game after his time off on Sunday. He's going to have a whole week of preparing and getting back into the groove of things And yeah, he is going to he's going to have probably 7 catches, maybe 8 catches for about a buck 20 and 2 touchdowns. And I wouldn't be shocked if Mike Evans goes off a little bit since he had kind of a quiet game on Sunday. He wants to get out there and perform too. And look, we don't need the defense to be as good as they were against Green Bay. We just need to keep them under 20 points and we will murder them. So that's all we got to do. By the way, their team is they're one of the worst defenses in the league. They're allowing 30.5 games or points per game right now. Just looked at it. Yep. There you go.
Yeah, they got a rough-looking secondary in Vegas for sure. I think Tom Brady and those wide receivers you mentioned could have themselves a big day.
Yeah, baby. Put them on there. Put them on the board. Rhett Matthew, tell everybody how they can find you and the Cannon Fire podcast.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you. So if you guys want to check out the Cannon Fire podcast, we are anywhere podcast downloaded. If you want to check it out with video, which is the recommended way to watch the show, you can do that over on YouTube as well. Make sure you subscribe. You can click a little bell icon to be notified every time we upload a video or go live. You can find myself on Instagram and Twitter at Rhetticus, R-H-E-T-T-A-K-U-S. And if you follow me, I promise I'll follow you back.
Very, very nice. You can find Will and I, for all you Cannon Fire fans out there, on Twitter at Johnny B Comedy, at @home_made_man, of course, at Johnny B Show. And I am Johnny B Tampa on Instagram. Make sure you're following us. Dude, I'm just real quick. The Cowboys suck. Did you know that?
Getting worked right now. Yeah.
Oh, my God. I just looked over at my TV and, 28-3. They're going to be 2-4, and I think they're still going to be leading their division. That is so pathetic.
Somebody crunched the numbers, and I guess like as of right now, it is mathematically possible for the NFC East division leader to get into the playoffs at like 4-12.
Yeah, I hope so. Love to see it. Rhett, thanks, man. I appreciate you, buddy. We will talk to you soon, and go Bucs, man.
Hey, I appreciate you guys. I'm looking forward to next week. Go Bucs, baby.
Yeah, there you go. Rhett Matthew, everybody, Cannon Fire Podcast. Let us take a break, skis, and when we come back, we're going to start doing some of this Halloween content. We have some. We're starting to pile it up. This one I love. We usually talk about this every single year around Halloween, and we get a new list, and we have one of the most haunted real-life places right here in Tampa Bay. We'll talk about it. If you got a place that you know of, give us a call. It's the Johnny B Show.
It's the Johnny B Show on 102.5 The Bone.